song for the broken hearted. A silent prayer for faith departed. Hi guys, welcome to the Young Musicians Matter podcast. Podcast for any young musician anywhere in the world. Doesn't matter what genre of music you love listening to, and it doesn't matter what instrument you play. This is a great podcast for you to come hang out, hear some information, something that might inspire you, some new books to read, recordings to listen to, have a bit of fun on the way. And one of the other things we do is interview professional musicians right at the top of their business. But the crucial thing about these interviews, guys, is they're talking about their young lives as musicians when they were your age. They're not talking about, oh, yeah, I'm in the London Symphony Orchestra, I'm in Bon Jovi. Well, we know that. Yeah, we know that's great. But what we want to talk about is how did you get there? What struggles you came across? And how did you get your first gig? And that's the gems, guys, of those interviews. So you young musicians out there, these interviews are priceless, you know. And we've got a fantastic interview coming out on this podcast with the euphonium legend that is Andy Fawbert, who played on the BBC Proms last night, and he's played with BBC big bands, he's played with all the London orchestras, he's done films, he's done shows. You would have heard his playing on the radio and TV and everywhere. And it's a good pal of mine, and it's a really lovely interview. Now, just to say, in this interview coming up later, there's an absolute gem of a bit of information that every young musician should put in your noddle. Yeah, should put it right in your head about attitude to gigging. It's a really important one. And when he said it, I just thought, my gosh, everybody should know that. I wish I'd known that at 14, 15, 16, 17. I wish I just put that in my head. It's a brilliant nugget. So just check that out. No skipping forward. It's there at the end. But you know what, guys? I was just coming to my head now, actually. It'd be really good if you had a notebook with you, you know, for all this sort of stuff. So you can just write stuff down, you know, as people say it, as I say it, or as Andy says it, or we had Pete Harrison last time, or you go to a masterclass, or you hear Steve Tyler or Mick Jagger being interviewed, and you just write little nuggets down, because that's a book. And then when you're a bit bored and you're uninspired, you could open up this book and then there'll be this little stuff in there that might inspire you. So anyway, great interview coming up. If you're visiting the podcast for the first time, you're really welcome. Lovely to have you with us. And can I just say, can you click that subscription button, which would be fab if you could, if you're watching on YouTube. Now, if we can go up one, I get really excited. That's really unambitious of me, isn't it? I should be saying, kind of, it'd be great if it went up 30, it went up 300. But I get thrilled if we go up one, actually. I'm actually quite worried because I'm really getting into this stuff about, well, we've got another one, somebody else has subscribed, or hey, we've got, you know, 250 views. I'm quite worried. I'm really getting into that stuff. So anyway, hit the subscribe button if you're watching on YouTube. Hit that notification button as well. Okay, ting, and I'll go off, because we've got some fabulous podcast coming out. The Pandon team, we've talked about some stuff that we're going to do, some really, really good ones. So you'll want to hear those, I'm sure. And if you're watching on the podcast apps, just great to download and keep us buzzing. That'd be fantastic. So look, the title of this podcast is called 7 Hot Tips of How to Put Your Phone Down and Turn Off Your Social Media and Do Some Practice. Okay, so that's what it's about. That's just coming up in a minute because I've got a big announcement to make. But first of all, these are going to be 7 tips that you can stick in your noddle, yeah, in your mind. You know, when you're sitting on the Xbox, you're sitting on the PlayStation, you're watching, you know, YouTube, you're watching Spotify, listening to Spotify, you know, all this stuff, and you've still got to practice, and you've done 5 hours social media. This is a great way of saying something in your head to get your bottom off the chair, or get yourself off the bed and go and do some practice, which sounds easy, but it's not easy. It's really difficult because this stuff's addictive and I find it difficult. So hopefully these are going to be 7 hot tips that will really help you to go into the practice room. Okay, so that's coming up very shortly. So that's I hope that'll be of interest to you. But now, before we get into that, actually, I've got this big announcement to make. And this big announcement is actually really, I'm thrilled with it, actually. And so we're going to announce this. Here, this is the announcement. This is coming. I've had to write it down. So I tried to learn it off by heart, but you're going to see why I failed miserably to learn this off by heart. So this is the announcement I want you to hear. So it goes like this. Let me clear the old throat. There you go. Okay. Konnichiwa, Nihon no razuni nu munisa yokoso. Donorudo shite nataki Navigati danya maiso. There you go. So look, if you I've practiced that so much, I got it off Google Translate. If you're Japanese, I hope you've understood what that is, because that was Japanese, hopefully. And I hope I haven't said something in Japanese that I didn't mean to say. But in Japanese, that said, welcome to all our Japanese listeners and thank you for your downloads. So the reason I've done that, and I didn't want to do it in English, because this podcast, this humble podcast, Young Musician Matters podcast, has made the music charts, podcast charts in Japan. I'm absolutely thrilled that people in Japan are downloading this in numbers. So there you go. All you guys out there in Japan, thank you so much. I hope that made sense. I haven't said something really weird in Japanese, but thank you so much for what you did and downloading us and listening to us do this stuff and stick with us and hit the subscribe button. Okay, good. So I hope that's that little job done, because that was really important. Okay, so now we're going to get into the two meaty bits of this podcast. And, you know, practice, guys, is so important. You know, if you want to be good at anything, and it doesn't matter when you want to be a crossbow archery, you want to be a potter, you want to be a dancer, you want to be a scientist, if you want to be the best at anything, you have to practice it. It doesn't matter what it is. I don't care what it is. You know, you have to practice it. So this is kind of important. So anything. So here we go. This is now 7 hot tips of how to put your phone down and get your social media switched off and actually do some practice. Now, it doesn't, just because you find that difficult doesn't mean you don't like practicing, doesn't mean you don't love playing the bongos or the trumpet. It's not. And can I just say, guys, I want to be really upfront with you on this one, because I would find this difficult, all right? I would find this really difficult. Now, when I was 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, there were 4 TV channels. 4, that was it, okay? Can you believe that? BBC One, BBC Two, ITV, and Channel 4. Channel 4 just getting going, really. And that was it, okay? I remember when breakfast television came on for the first time. I think I was about 11 or 12. And it's like, whoa, we can watch television at 7 in the morning, 9 in the morning? And then I think, if I remember rightly, it went off. And then it came back on about in the afternoon sometimes. But I can actually remember TV not starting when I was very young, not starting until 4 o'clock. So there was no computers. There was no YouTube. There was no Netflix, no Amazon Prime, no TikTok, no Instagram, nothing, no mobile phones. There was nothing. I had nothing, none of those things going on in my life or in anybody's life. And so I didn't have those temptations. I call them temptations. I don't call them distractions. Lots of people call them distractions, but I think they're brilliant. I'm sorry. I love YouTube. What a great invention is YouTube. I love Spotify. They're fantastic. Netflix. If I was your age, I'd absolutely ding dong this. I'd be absolutely thrilled to have all this stuff going on. Netflix, you know, Prime, Spotify. It's fabulous. Phone. My God, that's amazing. You know, text your mates, check them out. It's fabulous. You know, you've got a whole library at fingertips. I had to actually physically go to the library, get on a bus and go into Seven Oaks and get a book and come back again. And sometimes I didn't have the book. So it's not a distraction. I think they're fantastic. I just think they're huge temptations and they're very, very addictive. And of course, they're meant to be addictive. They want you to keep tuning into YouTube. They want you Netflix. They don't want you to go. And that's why, same with PlayStation. They don't want you to stop playing the games and Xbox. They want to keep you doing it. You know, that's the whole point. That's why they make the content so amazing. And it is amazing. But it is very difficult. And therefore, it is really difficult to stick this stuff down and go and pick up the trumpet, you know, which is not a quick fix thing. You know, learning a musical instrument, you're not going to get done quickly. You're not going to be brilliant quickly. So I really kind of get it with you guys how difficult this is. And it's a much more of a challenge to you than it is for me when I was a young musician. So, you know, I was just thinking, you know, what can I do to help? And here's my 7 top tips, all right, to get off that media, get that instrument in your hand and do some practice. And I know it's not that you don't want to do it. I just think it's just very, very difficult with so many temptations. Okay, so look, tip number one is actually a general one. Actually, this one is sort of benefits the next 6, if you like. If you kind of get this one right, it will help you later on decide on the next 6. Well, before we do this, tip one is, I think, well, I'd really love it if you went to a quiet space for 5 minutes, 10 minutes and check out your DNA. All right. This is called what's your DNA is tip number one. And what I mean is, I don't want you to go away and say, well, I'm good at maths and I'm good at hockey and I'm terrible at rugby. I don't want that. That's shopping list. I want you to go away and actually think about what sort of person am I? You know, am I good in the morning? Am I lazy? And do I like lying in? Am I confident? Do I get anxious? Do I get nervous? Is my concentration level good? Is it bad? But be kind to you when you do this. Stick the good stuff in. If you've got brilliant concentration, just say, I'm brilliant at concentrating, you know, and I'm fantastic at 5 o'clock in the morning. I'm wide awake. Like I'm a wide awake at the moment at 5 o'clock in the morning in this office because I was just wide awake. So be kind to you. Don't be all Christian. We tend to always do the bad stuff, but do the good and the bad. Yeah, put them both down. But it's really important that when you come to do practice and you try and do practice, that it fits you. Your DNA, you are unique. The trouble is we try and fit everybody else's practice ideas. You know, I'll try and squeeze myself into this one. So you might get somebody saying, oh, it'd be brilliant if you practice at 6 a.m. before you go to school. It's brilliant. Well, if you're somebody that can't get out of bed because that's your DNA, and you know, you might be able to do it for 3 or 4 mornings and then it just doesn't fit you. So what you're trying to do is do something that just actually doesn't fit. So that, of course, it's going to go bananas. It's going to go wrong. It's not going to, you know, it's not going to work. So finding out your DNA is what makes you tick, what you're good at, what you're not so good at, will really help. And then you make the practice fit you, not the other way around. So that's tip number one. Okay. Tip number two is called competitive practice. Okay. Now, I'm quite competitive, actually. I've grown up. I wasn't when I was young. When I was your age, I was not competitive at all. Okay. But I've become very competitive. I want to be the best acoustic guitarist I want to be. I wanted to be the best head of department I could be. I want to be the best. I'm playing piano in care homes and singing. Can you believe that? But I still want to be the best I can be. So I practice it. You know, I'm very competitive. I want to be the best. I want to be the best I can be. Now, if you're in your DNA, if you decided that you are a really competitive person, when you're on Netflix and Amazon, you need to say competitive practice, because that's something that inspires you, you know, because if you're competitive, that will just make you think, ah. Now, and I've got a little tip that my trumpet teacher gave me. I was on a bit of a go slow on practice at college, and he said to me, oh, Paul, look, I've got to have a chat with you about this. And, you know, every day that you miss practice, the person that you're going to audition against or you're going to interview against in a few months' time or years' time isn't missing practice. They're practicing. So every time you miss, the person you're going to be up against for a job, a trial, an interview is practicing, and they're getting further ahead of you. So every time that happens, you don't do that. And it's going to get to a stage when you get to that interview and you get to that, trial for the orchestra, you're not going to get it. You're going to be miles off because the person hasn't missed their practice. They've done it. They've done it. So that really spurred me on. I thought, that's such a good point. That's brilliant. And that's so true. So if you've got competitive DNA, you're sitting on WhatsApp and you're having a great time for 4 hours and you're feeling a little bit guilty, you haven't practiced, just say to yourself, competitive practice. I'm not. While I'm on this WhatsApp, the person I'm going to be up against for an interview is not doing WhatsApp. They're practicing. So that's tip number two, competitive practice. Yeah. Tip number three is be comfortable. So in other words, when you do your social media, when you do your phone, and when you do your Xbox, I get that you would be in a comfortable place. You'd be on your bed, you'd be on the sofa. If you're like my son, he's got this amazing gaming chair, which is better than my chair in the office. You know, you are in a very comfortable place. You know, it's great. You've got a sarnie next to you, a bit of chocolate, nice Diet Coke. You know, you've got everything there. You're relaxed. You're having a great time. It's comfortable. You know, and then your practice place is the coal shed. Well, if that is the case, there's absolutely no way you're going to get out of that bed or the comfortable chair and go and practice in the coal shed, because it's horrible. It's cold and it's not a very nice place to be. So be comfortable. Your practice place has to be a place that you're going to be comfortable in. You know, I had a pupil once. We were having a chat. I've forgotten his name. And we were having a chat and he said, oh, Mr. D, I'm really, you know, I'm finding practice really difficult. And I said, oh, okay, don't worry. He said, why? So join the club, you know. And he said, and I said, why is that? And he said, oh, my family don't like it. They tell me to shut up when I play the cornet. So I said, well, what do you do about that? And he said, well, I have to practice in the airing cupboard. So this guy was practicing in the airing cupboard. I said, what? And he said, also, I go in the airing cupboard so my neighbours can't hear it. And I said, well, let's call him Bert. I said, Bert, if you're practicing the airing, no wonder you don't want to practice. And he said, yeah, I get really hot and sweaty and it's really small and I can only last about 10 minutes. And I was like, God's sake, you need to get out of the airing cupboard. No, don't you? I wouldn't want to. If I had to practice in the airing cupboard, I wouldn't want to practice. So being comfortable is really important. I had another girl pupil who was brilliant. She loved playing in churches. And so what she did, she went down to the local vic and said, "Hey, vicar, can I practice in the church?" He said, "Yeah, it's always open. Come when you like." And she'd go three or four times a week down the church because she felt great and she loved playing in there and it made her play better. So that's a classic example. Be comfortable. Make sure your practice is a place that is yours. It's comfortable. It's as good as your PlayStation gaming chair or your bed. You know, it's a place where you're going to feel comfortable. Okay. Tip number four is called friendly fear. Now, this is a real bugbear of mine, actually. This is one that really, if there's something that gets my goat, it's this. All of you out there as young musicians are in wind bands or string quartets or orchestras or, I don't know, yeah, rock bands. You're doing Cayley groups, you're doing brass bands, okay? And when in all those groups are friends of yours and colleagues of musicians, okay, who are there, right? So they are all doing their stuff, all right? Let's take a string quartet for argument's sake. So you're in a string quartet. There's four of you. Three of you are practicing, right? Three of you are doing it. And they're getting out, they're putting the game station, the station down, and they're putting down their phone, and they're going to practice. Okay, and they're doing it. And you're not. You're the person that spends the 6 hours on the PlayStation and 7 hours on Netflix, and you don't practice. You then turn up to rehearsal, and the other three, and you're letting the other three down. You're letting them down big time. I mean, really big time. They've really worked. And you come in, and not only do you not know the notes well enough, what's even more worrying is physically you can't get through. And that's the point about practice. You've got to remember, it's not just learning notes. It's keeping you, whether you're a violinist, a rock guitarist, a drummer, a trumpet player, or a flautist, it's keeping you in physical playing shape as well. It's doing two things. And so, you know, I've been in loads of rehearsals where the second trumpet, halfway through the wind band, can't play after an hour because they just physically, and it's just a nightmare. The first trumpet can play really well. The second oboe is doing great. They've got plenty of stamina. And now they're being let down by this guy or girl who hasn't bothered to practice. And you're letting all your friends down. You're letting the music down. You're letting everybody down by not practicing and being ready in an ensemble. And if you can't do that, then you shouldn't be an ensemble. It's a real bugbear of mine, actually. And I think it's really disrespectful to think that you can just turn up having not practiced and sit and expect others to just think that's okay. So if you're sitting on your Netflix and your Amazon Prime and you haven't done any practices for 3 days and you've got a wind band, call it friendly fear. You know, there's that fear. You're going to let people down. If you don't go and practice, do a little bit of practice, you're letting your friends down. And that is not a good place to be. It's just not right. It just doesn't sit right. Okay. So that's a real, you can tell that's a real bugbear of mine. Okay. Number five on the seven hot tips on how to put your phone and social media down and do some practice is the drip, drip factor. Now, this goes back to your DNA, actually. If your concentration isn't very good, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. My concentration, I've got a lousy memory. I've got a really appalling memory. So, but I know that. And if your concentration isn't very good, just think drip, drip, drip. You know, it's very easy to sit for hours and hours on a phone or hours and hours on. And I've done it. I've sat hours on YouTube. I watch rock videos till about 2 a.m. for about 3 hours. It's easy to do that. And it's great. There's nothing wrong with it. I think it's great. I love it. But, you know, what you could do is just say, what to get you off that YouTube, what I often say to myself is, I'll just go and do 20 minutes. I don't say I'm going to go and do 2 hours practice. Okay, I don't say that. Because if you go, I'm going to do, you think, oh God, I've got to do 2 hours practice. If you just say, I'm going to go do 20 minutes, I'm just going to go 20 minutes for me, lip slurs and long notes and some scales. Then I'll come back and do something else. And then I say, right, I'm going to do 20 minutes. I've got Calamity Jane coming up in a couple of weeks' time. I'm going to practice 20 minutes on Calamity Jane and go back a bit with the PlayStation. It's called the drip, drip factor, yeah? So you just do little bits. And if you do that 3 or 4 times a day, you've done an hour's practice and you've done really good. As long as that 20 minutes is really good practice, and that's coming up in later podcasts, some tips how to do that, then that's great. Doesn't matter. It's the regularity of it that's really, really important. And of course, that keeps you physically shaped, so you don't let your friends down and the wind band down and the music down. So that's really important. So it's called the drip, drip factor. Don't set off and say, if you're not the sort of person that can do a 2 hours practice. Yeah, if you are, if you're somebody that concentrates for an hour, that's great. It's knowing your DNA is the really important bit. Okay. The next one is a phrase you may have heard before, is fail to prepare, prepare to fail. Okay, that's another thing you can say in your head when you're sitting on Netflix. You know, it's a really important one. If you've got an audition coming up, you've got an exam coming up, anything like that. If you fail to prepare, you better fail yourself. You better prepare yourself to fail. You know, you're going to fail. It's as simple as that, you know, and there's no way around that, actually. It doesn't matter what you do in life. If you don't prepare properly, you're not going to be very good. So there's a really good one also for lessons. And nobody puts lessons in this. They always talk about exams and they always talk about concerts. But I always think your weekly lesson. If you fail to prepare, prepare to fail in your lesson, because your lesson is really, really important. And you go in, and I'll tell you what, teachers are like dogs, right? Music teachers are like dogs. We can smell somebody who hasn't practiced when the way they walk in and the way they talk, we've got that instinct about us. We know, you can't kid us. We know. And you know what? If you do some practice during the week, you'll go in and have a great lesson, and your teacher will be buzzing, and you'll be buzzing, and you'll be able to both move forward and get to the next lesson. But if you haven't, it's like, oh gosh, you know, we're stuck. You know, you're both stuck. And of course, you don't enjoy it. You're going into that lesson thinking, oh, I'm practicing, and what am I going to say? I'm going to get found out. So you're into this anxious mode. You know, you're not going to go into that lesson in a really good attitude. Whereas if you say, oh, I've done some practice this week and I've really sorted that out. And I really want to ask things will come up in your practice. So you want to ask your teacher, which is brilliant. There's nothing better for a teacher than you walk in and said, well, I've done 6 hours on this oboe sonata. And you know what? I've got a few questions about it. It makes my day, because it says, wow, you're really interested in what I've got to say, and you're really interested in the music. So, you know, that thing is you're not failing to prepare for just an exam. You're failing to prepare for a lesson. And those lessons are really important, because that's your expert coming in and going, this is what I can do to help you. They're the people that can move you on, but they can't move you on unless you do the work outside of lessons. It's same with mathematics, same with geography, it's same with sport. Doesn't matter what it is. So fail to prepare, prepare to fail. Yeah, it's tip number six. Okay, tip number seven, and this is the last one. And I think this one's going to surprise you, but it's one I really believe in, actually. And it's called practice is attractive. So when you're sitting on your Xbox and you've done your seventh hour of FIFA, say to yourself, practice is attractive. Okay. Now, the reason I say this is, I'm going to be really honest here, and I love being around people who are dedicated, hardworking, really want to be the best that they can in whatever they do. I find them really exciting. I find them really interesting. And, you know, they're really confident people, you know, because they're practicing, they're working, and they're doing something, they're trying to be the best they can be. And so because they're like that, I find those people really confident. They're really confident. And I like being around people like that, because it makes me feel, wow, yeah, I feel inspired. That's what I want to do. These are attractive people. These are people who are going places. They want to do something with their lives. They want to, whether it be making sponge cakes or making rockets, it doesn't matter what it is. I love being around people who are dedicated, hardworking, really want to achieve something, do something with their lives. You know, it can even be a parent. You know, if you're a mum or a dad, you want to be the best mum in the world. You want to, that's fabulous. It doesn't matter what it is. I find it inspiring. I find it helps me. It makes people attractive, you know. And what's really interesting, if you're like that, if you're really dedicated and you're inspiring, you work hard and you want to be the best you can be, you become attractive. You will attract people. They will want to be with you. They'll want to work with you. They'll want to ask your opinion. They'll want to find your ideas. They'll want to do all those things with you. They'll be coming up to you going, God, I love that. Have you thought of that? Can I borrow that? Can I buy that off you? Can we do some duets? Do you want to come and do a gig? You know, can you come around for a party? You'll just start, if you practice and you become dedicated at anything, but we're talking about music, you will become a better person. You will be, everybody will want to be with you, and you will attract brilliant people will come to you. And of course, the more those people come to you, the more you spin off them and the better you become as a person. It's really, no one ever talks about this, but that is really important. If you've got a goal in your life and an aim, and you just want to be the best you can possibly be, and then hopefully be the best, then you become a very, very interesting person and an inspiring person. People will be inspired by you. They'll go, wow, that guy or that girl, she was amazing. How the heck did she? I find that so inspiring. Whereas if you're all a bit kind of, well, that'll do and I'll get by and I can wing it and it doesn't really matter, it's really dull, actually. And after a while, it's a bit boring. actually, being around people like that. I find it a bit boring. It's a bit, okay, that's fine. You can be like that. It's your life. It's not, I haven't got a problem with it. But I want to be inspired and be around those sorts of people. So number seven, practice is attractive. It makes you attractive. Yeah, hardworking. So there we are. There's the seven hot tips. We'll put them at the end. And hopefully those are things you can say in your head. All right. Those, when you're on social media, they are the things you can say in your head to get off the couch, get out of the bed, get off the gaming chair, chuck away TikTok. Don't come back to it. It's absolutely fine. And do some practice, because it, I tell you, practice does a lot for you as a person. Even if you don't want to be a professional musician, you learn about dedication. You learn about long-term aims and not short-term games. You understand to achieve something quite wonderful takes time, and it's not going to be a quick fix, which is very difficult now when everything is so quick. So there you go, my seven hot tips of how to turn your phone off and put your social media down and go and do some practice. And I never found practice easy. Can I just say that? And we've got some great podcasts coming up about what happens when you get in the room, that first few minutes and stuff during those. That's all coming up. Great. Okay, guys, I hope you enjoyed that. And I hope that's been of help. So now we come up to the last minute bit of the podcast. And this is a great pleasure. So I'm delighted to introduce to you Mr. Andy Fawbert. Now, he's a euphonium legend. He's, as I said earlier, he's played with all the top orchestras in the country, and the BBC Big Band, and he's on the proms. He's done it all. And check this interview out. It's the second in our series. And he's talking about his life as a young musician, what he faced, how he felt he went to London, what he felt, you know, how did he feel, and how he prepared, and all that sort of stuff. It's a lovely interview. I went down to Sherborne and sat in his kitchen. He's a lovely man. He makes the most fantastic cup of tea ever. And we had a lot of laughs. And what you've seen, the same with what you've just seen in the podcast, these podcasts are unedited. Okay. I have to say, we had to take one little bit of Andy's interview out where somebody walked in the room, but they didn't. And I said, oh, can you keep me on? They said, no. So I did take that out. But basically, all the podcasts you see now are unedited. It's as you see it, as it happens. And this is exactly how this interview went. And I just say a public thank you to Andy for being such a brilliant host and hanging out and saying, entertaining this interview so well. Ladies and gentlemen, it's lovely to see you. Thank you so much for listening to the podcast and being with me. And I hope it's been useful. And, you know, the biggest thing of all, above everything else, is be kind to you. Yeah. Here's Andy Fawbert, down in Shovel. Bye. Hi, guys. Welcome to the Young Musician Matters podcast on the road, again, on location. So second time on location. The first time we were over in Wales on a really busy market day and in a hotel. Complete contrast now. I find myself in Sherborne, in Dorset, in a very, very lovely, beautiful, actually, lovely kitchen. In actual fact, I can get my whole house in this kitchen. Seriously. And it's the kitchen owned by one of the, I believe, one of the legends of euphonium playing and trombone playing, a man who spent his whole professional life right at the top of the business, and just the nicest guy, and just a lovely company. And I've just thrilled he's in my life and as friends, and we know each other as players and gigs. Yeah. So this kitchen, this beautiful kitchen, belongs to Mr. Andy Fawbert.
Thanks, mate.
Lovely, Andy. Thanks for having me in your beautiful kitchen. You make really good tea as well, by the way, which I'm just going to grab.
Don't let it go cold.
Yeah, we've got to grab the tea. We need that bit. So we're going to have the tea a bit. Okay, there you are. Okay.
Here we go.
Here we are. We're good now.
I've got coffee. Just tea. Coffee.
In Sherborne. Okay. So as all these podcasts, they're about, when I interview or chat to musicians, it's not about where they are now. We know where Andy is now. It's kind of, when I was a young musician, I wanted to know how we got there. You know, all the things you used to do when I was 16, what were you doing at 17, what at 12, you know, how did it feel like? And how did you get that first pro gig? And Andy and I have known each other for a long time. I was trying to think, actually, when I first met you, and I can't remember it. Do you know what the first thing we did together?
I met you when, if you remember, Yvonne, my wife Yvonne, mm-hmm. she got a job at a really fantastic prep school, Hazelgrove School.
Oh, yeah.
And she did her year eight show.
Right.
And you came to play trumpet.
Was that the first time?
And you also did some cover teaching for her.
Oh, was that the first time?
She lost a trumpet teacher and came in and stepped into the breach.
And that was the first time I met you?
Yeah, and that would be 2005, I think.
Oh, wow. And he says
2005, 2006.
16 years. And then you came to work with me at Wells.
Yeah, I was there for, 4 or 5 years?
Yeah. And I remember one of the reasons I wanted to chat with Andy, because Andy came into, you came in depth in a band called DTA.
Yeah.
DTA plug, major plug to you. Fantastic.
DTA are a fantastic band. Mm. I depped in the band, about 3 weeks ago, didn't I? A couple of weddings. And what a fantastic night we had.
Yeah, it was great.
Playing all that lovely, you know, Proud Mary and sort of average white band stuff. It was great. And he played the trumpet.
Second trumpet, where I belong. But I mean, what was lovely, we were chatting, I took you and brought you back, didn't I? So I picked you up from this lovely house. And
yeah, you drove so I can have a drink.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Got that one wrong. But then I was like, we were chatting in the car, weren't you? And I'm like, oh God, Andy, all this stuff that you told me about. And I said, it'll make a great book. And I was saying, you should write a book about your young life as a musician. Yeah, I thought, I've got to have you on the podcast because it's absolutely ideal. So here we go. So Andy, look, so musical family, did you have a musical family? Was it before you even played a note? Could you remember music being around? Or?
Oh yeah. I mean, all my family, my dad, my sister, my aunties, my uncles, granddad, and all that. They were all in the local colliery band.
Oh, so they all played, yeah.
Yeah, we played in a band called Sherland Miners.
Right.
Sherland Miners Welfare Band,
right,
which was one of many, many bands in, right, colliery bands in that area.
Yeah.
And I just started to play the cornet when I was about five.
So that was all going on when you were like 1, 2, 3, 4, up till five.
Yeah, all that.
You heard it all in the house. That's amazing. So it was kind of right from birth.
Yeah, right from birth. And I didn't know anything else. I only knew people that played in the band.
And brass players.
Yeah, brass players, yeah.
And was there kind of a moment where, I don't know whether you can remember, where there was a spark where you thought, well, I want to play the cornet, or was it just the cornet was just put in your hand?
Well, they gave me the cornet, and I was sent home by my auntie, who was a teacher, with the C scale and all the fingering written underneath, and when you need to play a high note, you smile and press and all that business, which is not great.
That's
what happened. But I was not great on the cornet.
Right.
So then I was moved on to the tenor horn, and I was at it. And then finally, when I was about 12, I ended up playing the euphonium, and I was quite...
So you kind of went cornet?
Yeah, I got bigger, and I found that mouthpiece suited me, and I love playing the euphonium.
Yeah, oh, you're amazing.
I loved it. I still like playing the euphonium.
Yeah, and you still love it, even today.
Oh, yeah. In fact, I practice the euphonium quite a lot because I can sit on the settee and play it.
But
you can't do that with the trombone because you've got that bit that goes behind you. So I just sit watching the telly and playing tunes.
Yeah, I do that.
Which is great. Yeah.
And so who was your in your early teachers that taught you in that early age, you know, sort of, did they influence you? Can you remember particular teachers that you thought, wow, yeah, they really had a powerful effect on me as a musician?
Well, my auntie was my first teacher.
Oh, okay.
My Auntie Mary, and she used to be the lead trumpet of the Ivy Benson,
all-girls
band. Yeah. And she was still doing loads of gigs and all that sort of thing. So she was my first influence, and I saw that she'd go to band practice and she'd jump in her car with her trumpet, and she'd go somewhere, she'd go to Sheffield or Manchester to do a gig, which she got paid for. I thought, oh, that's great. You know, she's having a great time, and someone's giving her an envelope full of money at the end of the night. So that seed was planted.
Yeah.
And I used to go up to Yorkshire to have lessons with a really famous euphonium player called Geoffrey Whittam.
Right.
I used to go to the Hammond's Source Works factory to have my lesson with Jeff. And he was a huge influence. He was a fantastic, great player and a larger than life character. And he opened the door to the National Youth Band.
Oh, right.
And all that sort of thing.
So and now, over the last sort of, in your professional life, can you feel your auntie and that euphonium teacher's influence still?
Absolutely. And one other guy that, you don't like to put things in order of importance, because everybody that I deal with, they always have an influence on you, don't they?
Yeah, absolutely. Same one way.
And you still learn from the most unlikely sources, really.
Yeah, absolutely.
But this guy, I went to a sixth form college in Nottingham, where I met a guy called Doug Wilkie, who was a trombone player. He went to Trinity College, and he was working in Nottingham. And he said to me, he said, when you go home tonight, take the euphonium home with you and don't bring it back. Says, because you should play the trombone.
Right.
And I didn't really I didn't really want to do it, really, but I did. And my dad was, he was really upset that I was going to change instrument. Anyway, I started playing the trombone with Doug, and I just loved it straight away. I mean, I got to play in a brass quintet, in a big band, in an orchestra. I've never done that before.
So that was like a spark moment, wasn't it?
That was the door opening and going, come and have a look in here.
That's a really good way of putting it.
I sort of peered in and went, wow.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
And the brass bands, because that was all brass bands at that time for you, mostly.
All brass bands.
So what did that do for you? And what did you do for you then? And what does that influence you today when you play? What did the brass band world do? Do you think?
Well, I think more than anything, it gives you a technique,
right,
that you probably can't get from many other places.
Yeah, I agree.
And that stamina thing, because you don't stop playing.
And the reading, isn't it?
And the reading, yeah, because it's all loads of notes.
And was it quite disciplined? But the rehearsals, was it?
Yeah, they were
really disciplined.
Oh, yeah, serious business.
Yeah,
the bands. Especially when you're building up to go to a contest.
Right.
I mean, I still love my connection with bands. Yeah. I go and have a blow with the town band in Sherborne.
Great.
And but I've got a different view. The contest day is just a part of what we do. You know.
I don't
tend to get wrapped up in sort of like we've got to win.
No.
At all costs thing
it's
anymore.
It's not my thing at all.
No.
But I conduct, obviously, City Band.
But I do enjoy it, and I totally get it.
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
And I go to the British Open and the National Finals, and I listen to every band. They're amazing.
Yeah.
Still part of
that. So you still feel it. When you hear that, the hairs
go on the back of my head.
That's amazing, because that goes for 5 years old.
I feel it now.
It's amazing. Since 5 years old. That's a long time to keep loving something.
And I hope that will never leave me.
Probably too ingrained, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
And was music your only aim at that time? When you were like 12, 13, 14, those teenagers, were you kind of, it was just like music, that's all I want to do?
Well, I was playing in the band and I was in the National Youth Band.
Yeah.
But when this guy I told you about, Doug Wilkie, I got my first ever professional date with Doug.
Right.
We did a little show in Derby, I think it was, and we played in a show called The Merry Widow.
Oh, no, Merry Widow.
And I just
got to know that for years.
There was only two trombones, and I sat next to Doug, and off we went. and on the Friday night, this guy gave me an envelope with, I can remember how much it was, £88.
88?
Yeah, £88, which this is in 1974.
Wow.
And I thought, wow, this is great.
Actually, £88 in 1974 is a lot of money.
A lot of money.
Yeah, just think about it.
We were paid £11 per show. Anyway, so then I started to notice trombone players on the television.
Yeah.
You know, like Morecambe and Wise, and they're all there.
Yeah.
And so I used to think, how do they get from where I am to doing that?
Yeah.
And Doug was great help, and he said, you need to go to music college.
Okay,
which I did. I went to
And what was it about music that spoke to you? And that's a tricky question, isn't it? What was it about music that made you go, God, you know, like you talk very passionately now, all these years later.
Yeah.
You said the spine of your, you know, all your arm went tingle when you talk. So what was it about music? Can you put your finger on what it is about music that makes you go,
it was always important to me, but I knew, and this sounds a bit sort of mercenary, but I thought, if I can do this, that thing that I really love, I can make it my job, I mean, that's going to be win-win, isn't it?
Yeah. So music was always a heart. You always felt it.
Yeah. I mean, I told you before we went on air, I did a show last night at the Coliseum in ENO. And because I'm only in a very small part of the opera, I watched the first act.
Yeah.
And it was amazing.
Yeah.
And I still feel like that.
Great.
Especially when you listen to your colleagues play.
Yeah, yeah.
So amazingly well.
Yeah, that's what you said when we were chatting just now. Exactly that. You know, it's just like coming home.
Yeah, absolutely.
When you go to, you know, it's like coming home.
Yeah.
That's amazing. But it's incredible that somebody all those years can still love what they do. How many people can say that in their job?
Well, I think I think it's easy to get cynical
yeah.
about our job, yeah. but I don't know many people that actually are seriously cynical. No. They might toss the odd cynical comment in, but I think deep down they all think like me.
Yeah, because music's that emotional.
Yeah.
So when you were going through that sort of 12 to 18, what music were you listening to? What would you put on the old LP player? You know,
Well, I used to just play brass band music.
Right, so you...
I had a recording of a piece called Le Roi d'Ys, the King of Ys, right. which is an orchestral overture by Edouard Lalo.
Oh, yeah.
But there's a fantastic brass band arrangement.
Right.
And my teacher at the time, Jeffrey Whitten, played the euphonium with Black Dyke.
Yeah.
The Black Knight Band, and the cello solo in the middle is obviously transcribed for the euphonium.
Right.
And I wore the record out.
Did you?
Yeah, I just used to play. I could
see just that bit with the
euphonium. I just used to play that bit and listen, thinking, oh, I want to do that, you know. And lots of other brass band music.
Did you ever play that piece?
Yes.
You ended up doing it.
Oh, yeah. I played that piece.
That's great.
Yeah, in a competition and all that sort of thing. But after meeting this guy in Nottingham, Doug, I got into all sorts of things. So I started listening to orchestral music and big bands.
Yeah, because you do a lot of big band playing as well.
Yeah. And that just opened up this whole new
thing. From that brass band, which is
Yeah. Because I actually thought when I was about 10 years old that Beethoven's Fifth Symphony that I used to play in the band, I thought that Beethoven wrote it.
I know, I've never played like four range for brass band and all that.
I didn't know it was written for an orchestra before I was doing it in the band.
Yeah, that's right, same. So how did you, were you busy, looking back on that time when you were playing, you were busy playing?
Yeah.
In those times?
Every night.
Every night, yeah, great.
Every single night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, it's a busy.
I didn't know anything else.
No. Yeah, it's great.
I used to go to watch football matches. I'm a Derby County supporter, really.
Yeah, you said that.
So I used to still go and watch the Rams.
Because the mine that you were telling me, the mine that the band's attached to is in Derbyshire. It was Derbyshire mine, wasn't it?
Yeah. Between Derby and Chesterfield. Yeah.
But now you support Wickham.
Now I support Wickham Wanderers.
Do you kind of have a soft spot for Derby?
A big soft spot for Derby.
So Brian Clough a hero?
Total hero, yeah. Until he went to Nottingham Forest.
Until he went to Forest, yeah. Then he was like, that's like, I'm a Yeovil fan. It's like, because someone going to, being a Yeovil, going to manage Weymouth.
Yeah, absolutely.
So when you went to music college in Birmingham. So you come from this like mining sort of brass band world. And then how did you feel on going to Birmingham? Couldn't you wait?
I've done a little bit of sort of orchestral playing. And right. everything, but only at a very small amount, really. So when I got to Birmingham, it was just the biggest shock to my system. Because, I never spoke to anybody that played a violin or a
flute. Telling me that in the car.
I didn't.
I was 18.
I was 18, yeah.
You hadn't spoken to, that's amazing.
A few people at Nottingham, but mostly it's different there because I was a day boy, as everybody was. Yeah. But when you go to Birmingham, they're all the time.
So that was a big shock to the system.
Yeah. And I remember going into the first orchestra rehearsal. They used to put the name, you auditioned, and then they'd put the name on a list who was in the orchestra.
Yeah.
And I got in the orchestra in my first year to play bass trombone in the orchestra. Well, I didn't really know where they sat in this thing, so I just sort of waited until I saw two other guys walking and I plonked myself next to them, yeah.
It's amazing when you think young musicians now. They, go to college, and there's always that worry. It's a big change. Was the teaching different? Did you feel the teaching was a different way of teaching, or was it?
Oh yeah, so up a notch.
Really?
What a big notch! Yeah. It was.
In what way was it? Demanded more?
Much more technical. I mean, I'm used to play. I had a really sort of press and smile ambition, which I struggle on, especially the upper register and everything. So my trombone teacher said we'll do something about that. So I went through it.
So that's first year, an embouchure change.
Embouchure change, which was...
Because a lot of students get down by that, but you just got to get through it, haven't you?
Yeah. The guy helped me, Reg Reed, who was my trombone teacher, was great.
Yeah.
And he broke it down and...
Did it in a nice...
Did it in a great, great way, yeah.
And do you still play on that embouchure now?
Yeah.
That's great. Fantastic.
I was lucky because he didn't start doing it until right towards the end of my first year.
He let me settle in. Yeah,
and
then
he said, look, now we started about the May
June
time, and then he said, and then if you really get stuck in over the summer,
yeah, great. So you did it. So you had time to practice it.
Yeah,
and work at it.
Yeah.
Good teaching.
Brilliant. Yeah. Brilliant. Yeah, absolutely.
That's really good, because instead of diving in week one and you're all, you know, the students, yeah, you know, when what day of the week it is.
Yeah, exactly.
Especially coming, like, they come from the sticks around here, and then, and like you from a smaller community, then you're suddenly in this big city, aren't you? So that's good teaching.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, I've still got my accent, but I had a ridiculously strong Derbyshire accent. Yeah, so all these people, I said, well, my piano teacher was a very well-spoken lady. Mm. I mean, she just couldn't tell what I was talking about.
So she couldn't understand.
Yeah, no, she couldn't understand at all.
Was that the first time you played the piano? Was it college?
Or
you?
No, I did a little bit. I'm absolutely rubbish on the piano.
I'm sure they come.
Yeah, but I have got better recently. Yeah. I can accompany some of my children in their lessons now. But no, that was the first like serious piano lessons. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And what, just after, when you were at college or after college, when was your, what was your first pro gig and how did that come about? Because a lot of young people ask, oh, how do I get that first gig? And I'm like, gosh, there's so many. But for you, what was the route to get that very first big, what I call a big time date, you know, with the Lord? Can you remember it and how it came about?
Oh, I can remember exactly.
God, that's good.
There was a guy who used to, we had a brass band at the college,
right,
that was conducted by a guy called Roy Curran. And Roy was the third trumpet player in the CBSO,
right,
the Birmingham Orchestra. Yeah, yeah. And they were doing a piece called the Sinfonietta by Janáček that needed a whole host of extra players. So Roy really nicely said to the orchestral manager, he said, look, we've got some great lads and girls at the college.
Good for him.
Especially if to play the bass trumpets or the euphoniums.
Yeah.
So I got my first gig with the CBSO
doing the
Janáček,
the bass trumpet gods.
I played euphonium.
I played euphonium in that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, you can imagine.
CBSO?
Yeah, I mean, we were all beside ourselves, because they were, and still are, world-famous orchestra.
Was that in the town hall at Birmingham?
That was in the town hall, before. The conductor was a guy called Louis Fremo.
Right.
French guy who was a fantastic conductor and really nice man, and he was great with it because he knew we were all, he had a rows of young people in front of him that were all quaking in their boots.
Amazing. Fantastic.
Yeah.
That's great you can remember that. And then, so how did you get the first, I'm fascinated, how did you get the first BBC Prom Last Night gig? Because you did that for years, didn't you, on euphonium. Can you remember the first one you got and how it came about?
Yeah.
Because that was a big thing, wasn't it, to get that chair?
Oh, it was fantastic, yeah.
Because people say Andy Fawbert, they all go to me, last night the Proms.
My mum used to think that was the only day that I worked. Yeah. But
how did you get that? Because you weren't in the B, were you, as a player?
Well, in about 1983, I got a job with the BBC Radio Orchestra.
Okay.
Which now longer...
On trombone.
We had four trombones, and I was bass trombone in there. So the section was Gordon Campbell,
right,
who everybody knows.
Yeah,
Gordon Campbell, a guy called Russell Howarth, a guy called Eddie Larkin, who was on the jazz chair, and me on four trombone. And Gordon and I, we joined on the same day, actually, October 1983, I think.
Yeah.
Anyway, we were in Studio 3 in Maida Vale.
Right.
And the symphony orchestra were in Studio 1.
Right.
So we just got to know people and we chatted away and blah, blah, blah. And when I left after about 5 years, Tony Parsons, who was the co-principal trombone, said, oh, get Andy to come in. And so I did a couple of dates on the youth and a couple of dates on the trombone.
Yeah.
And then I did the first Last Night the Proms.
So it's kind of that. If you connect all this up, it's like it's all who you know, isn't it? People help people that you keep talking about. I love the way you talk about. You keep talking about doors. People open doors for you because you knew people. You weren't shut away. You were meeting people.
And people are really kind.
Yeah. And how did your first teaching job came about? Because a lot of students they need that teaching job. Don't they? Can you remember your first teaching job? How that came about?
I can remember my. I used to, because Yvonne, my wife, has always been a music teacher. Yeah. Wherever she was the director of music, I used to
go in and teach.
Go and teach inevitably.
Yeah, of course.
You know, that's that connection. So I always used to that. But the first sort of, you know, proper teaching job outside of a school was I taught at the London College.
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember John McCabe?
Yeah, John
McCabe was the director.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
And one of the horn players in the radio orchestra was a lovely guy called Tony Randall.
Yeah.
Who was everybody in that.
Yeah.
If you don't know about Tony Randall, you should check him out.
Yeah, absolutely.
Great horn player and a busy session player. Yeah. And he was the head of brass at the school.
Right.
And he when I left the radio orchestra, he said, do you want some teaching? So I did that for about probably 10 years, actually.
That's good. So that was your first teaching job?
Yeah, and I looked at there. It was in town.
Yeah.
It was on...
Was it near Marrowbone? No.
No, it was near the Palladium.
Oh, that's right.
On whatever that street is there, Great Marlborough Street or something.
Great Marlborough Street, yeah, I think around there.
Yeah, of course it was. A beautiful building.
Yeah, it was.
So I could, if I was working in the West End or wherever,
yeah.
I could just nip in and do my teaching.
That's great. So your first playing date was big one, CBSA. Your first teaching's at London College was amazing.
Yeah,
And with gigs, do you have a pre-gig routine or an after-gig routine? You know, before you go on stage, is there anything you do? What do you do after the gig as well?
I probably go to the pub with them. Try to sort of be sensible and do it. Yeah, and
but you don't have any superstitions, like you don't get there about 4 hours early and. You're not
I haven't got any superstitions. No.
Some people have, they're a real routine, don't they?
They
have to do that. Yeah. And after the gig, it's just you're saying after you love to go off with the guys for a drink. And...
Yeah, I mean, it's the most fantastic job, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because you, like I say, it's something that you love doing.
Yeah.
And there's always someone there that you haven't seen for a while.
Absolutely. Yeah. And if you had to point out some high points, and it's really difficult just putting on your spot, but there are some high points you go, wow, those are the moments in my career when I really thought, wow. Does that make sense?
I won't be modest. No, those last night at the Proms was such the most fantastic date.
Yeah.
And I think we talked about it in the car. Mm. It's never your date.
No. I love that. Even if you've
done the last night of the Proms for 4 years, if you start getting into the thinking, I do that all the time.
Mm.
That's the road to ruin.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, because it's never your date. No. It's a privilege to be asked to do that date.
That had a powerful effect on me in the car. You know, and I've known you for 16 years, but I had a really when we were talking about that in the car, just that's so good because you were talking about and also about what is it? Always be grateful when the phone rings.
Yeah,
whatever
the gig. Absolutely.
And I thought that's so good, isn't it?
And don't be an idiot when you get there thinking, I'm probably, there's no such thing as a bad gig, is there?
A
date is a date. So turn up on time and just do what you do.
Yeah, I thought it was fab. I thought it was fab what you said. And have you ever thought, young musicians, because we work with them and, they get moments where they want to give up. Did you ever have a moment where you thought, I've done it, I don't want to do this anymore? Or have you always just thought, never had that thought?
I did get to a point when it was really I went away from home a lot on tour.
Yeah,
And
that sounds glamorous, doesn't it?
It does.
People listening who are 16 and 14 are going to go, "Wow, I'm going to go to Japan. I'm going to go to America." But
because I was married and we Yvonne and I had two little boys, and I think I probably went away too much.
Right.
To be honest.
Yeah.
Okay. So that was hard.
Yeah, and you did think, is this the right?
Yeah, so in about 2006, I got a chance to get a teaching job, a head of brass job at Sherborne School.
Yeah, you did a great job there. Great.
So
job.
I did that,
and
that was, I think that was a game changer, really.
Yeah.
Just
built that up, folks. I mean, you built. I remember because I was here 35 years. So and then suddenly you went there in Sherborne. Suddenly we all started to hear about Sherborne Brass. It was great. It was kind of built that up, didn't you?
Really? I mean, even though I'm not the head of brass anymore, I stopped doing that about 3 years ago. I do a day's trombone teaching, and I've got 13 students there.
Amazing! That's incredible.
Yeah, and they're good. Four or five of them are accomplished players. Yeah, they're grade eights. Couple of bass trombones. Yeah,
that's amazing.
Yeah, all grade seven, grade eights.
Envy of the country. Boys. Schools would die for that. They'd die for two like that. Two trombones.
Yeah,
like that.
They would. Yeah.
And So we kind of touched on it just now. This bit could go on forever because I know you've got amazing advice for young musicians. What's who are listening and watching, because there are quite a few of them. What's the big advices that you've got that you can things that you could pass on? You mentioned one, just that I love that one about there's no such thing as a bad day. Is there anything else?
Yeah, I think you've got to be. You need. I call it the two T's. Yeah,
okay.
You need talent.
Yeah.
And tenacity.
Lovely.
Okay. I mean, just. Be like a dog with a bone.
Yeah.
And just get stuck in and work hard.
And don't hide away.
And listen.
Yeah, listen.
Listen.
You mean to lots of music.
Listen, and to people's advice.
Yeah.
And then you can, as you get more mature, you can filter it.
Yeah.
So whatever appertains to
you. And we don't stop. Do you feel you've ever stopped learning? Do you think?
Never.
You said that earlier about half an hour ago. You drop that little nugget in that you'll always learn.
Always.
Yeah. But then I hear you play and I think, oh, God, you sound so good. You know, like, but there's always something to learn.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
That's fascinating that you still, and you like learning.
Yeah, I love it. Especially when something drops a little, teaching hint drops into your lap and someone says, oh, I get my kids to do this.
Yeah.
And I think, wow, why did I even think of that?
I've heard that so many times.
Yeah. Or from a student. Yeah. So what have you been doing this week? Well, I thought I'd have a go at doing this.
Right.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's really clever. Yeah. I'll do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can learn off students. That's Scott.
Yeah.
Big time.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's really good nuggets. Really, really, really good nuggets. So last question. Great, I could talk to you all day. This is a toughie because you're putting you right on the spot. If there was I was asked this on local radio once, and we're on the spot live, and I was like, I felt like it was a 4-hour silence because I thought, oh my God. The guy said, this is like 20 years ago, he said, Paul, can you give us one song, if you could have one song or one piece of music, and that's the only piece of music you could have for the rest of your life until you pop your clogs. What would it be? And then kind of, I'm like, where do you start? But is it, if you had one piece of music you could take with you to the other side, let's put it like that. That's tough because there's so much great music.
Well, because it's such a lot of music, I would take the Ring Cycle.
Because there's so much of it.
Because there's so much of it and it's all great.
Yeah, it is great.
Yeah. But if you want to narrow it down to one piece, I think it, because I've got such a connection with the piece.
Yeah.
It is a piece that Richard Strauss said, I'm Held in Labour.
Oh, right. Interesting. Great piece.
So
can I ask what your connection with that is?
Yeah. I used to do a lot of work with the Philharmonia.
Yeah, right.
And when Dudley Bright was the first trombone, Dudley Bright, Peter Goodwin, and Bob Hughes.
Yeah. Wow, what a section.
And I used to go in as like the extra fourth trombone, but we did a concert of Held in Labour in the Musikverein in Vienna.
Oh, gosh, wow.
And it was such a fantastic, it was.
You can't say you actually can't put into words.
No, it was incredible.
Yeah, okay. I know that feeling. Yeah, it's great.
So it's got that connection because if you do a lot of work with people, especially if you go on tour with them, they become more than a colleague, although you don't see them probably out of work.
Yeah, right.
They become, you have that sort of real musical connection.
Yeah, you do.
With them. So,
and it's an emotional connection, isn't it?
Yeah.
Playing emotional stuff.
Yeah.
Great.
And the last section, so the last sort of coda, if you like, the 6-8. To the end is just.
Still gets you.
Mm. And it's a great euphonium part as well.
Yeah.
Fantastic euphonium part.
Fantastic part.
So, that.
So, Andy, that is incredible chat with you. Really, really good. I could go on for hours. You know that because I talk to you a lot.
I know.
So this guy is an amazing guy. And, you know, you've been an amazing friend to me. We talked all about your, and there's some lovely connections, how it all still influences you today. All the stuff that you did the younger all there, isn't it? It's sitting inside you.
It all goes into the big mix.
Yeah. And so this guy's at the top of the business, and you'd have heard Andy's playing on records and not realized it and all that sort of stuff. There's all that other stuff that we haven't touched on is the professional life, but people would have heard you playing and not realized who these people are. And that's why I've tried to do these interviews so we find out who these people are.
Like being adverts.
Yeah. God, I didn't know that. And not only that, you've just been a great friend to me. And, you know,
well, that's the easy bit.
Because I've been through some, and I'll leave this on, don't worry, nothing's edited. You know, I've been through some pretty tough times, and you were just one of the best people ever to me. You were just, you did simple things to me, you said simple things, you kept in touch, you just popped me a little text, said, Paul, are you okay? And I said, just meant the world. I don't think you realized, but you were just a great pal.
I do, because people do that to me. You know, I've got some friends that you were fantastic, still keep in touch a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, but you had that sixth
sense. Can I say who they are?
Yeah, of course you can. Yeah, yeah, we get a lot of web viewing.
Two guys, actually.
Yeah, same.
Always keep in touch.
Yeah.
Two or three.
Yeah.
A guy called Jim Maynard.
I don't know him, but I've heard of him.
Jim was second trombone in the LSO. Right. Sends me a lot of texts.
Good, great.
Just, you know, every 2-3 months I get a little funny text. And Phil, a guy called Phil White.
I know Phil, yeah, of course.
Sends me funny text.
Good, great.
Yeah, he's good. And Pat Jackman.
Pat Jackman was at junior college, Jack.
Pat's in the bass trombone and opera house. He always, if any little special sort of trombone drinking nights or special nights, I always get a text from Pat. He never forgets.
Nice lad.
And I saw him a couple of nights ago.
There you go. Still in touch.
In person, yeah.
Great. Andy, thank you so much, man.
Pleasure.
I really, 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 really appreciate it. Thank you guys for tuning in and listening. And of course, we always end with saying, whatever happens, be kind to you. Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah, important.
This ain't a song for the broken hearted. I ain't gonna be just a face in the crowd. You're gonna hear